возвращаясь уже к теме своего доклада, и тоже позволю себе некоторое отступление. Мы с Владимиром Федоровичем много обсуждали протокол.
Couple of more words. We discussed with a lot with Vladimir Fedorovich about when prepared the study, and Vladimir mentioned the story how he introduced organ sparing interventions in our institution and then tried to advocate for them in the territory of Russia, and how hard was to talk to the management there, and how hard was to talk to the surgeons providing soldiers, even in expanded surgery by Urban Holden. It was very hard to prove that organ sparing intervention can be applied, that our patients needs them, that they are safe, and it was indeed a revolutionary technique which was very hard to break through, so to say, to see the stars. But today there is no more question. Organ sparing for such procedures today are routine, conventional, and there's no issue for argument, but it just it was very short time in before it was not the case. And discussing and talking about the study, we decided to give it a bit of a revolutionary name, de-escalation of surgical intervention. So, non-official, we call it refusal of surgery in breast cancer patients. And it has some background. The background is that neoadjuvant chemotherapy turns to be an integral part of treating patients with breast cancer. And even at the early stages, stage one or two, we see more patients being treated with neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Moreover, biologically aggressive subtypes, HER2 positive, triple negative, triple negative patients, they turn to be patients with great, very good results, with complete pathological regress. Of course, we understand that it's a surrogate marker, but we do not have any other replacement, so we use complete pathomorphological regression as a measurement for effectiveness of treatment. And in case of biologically aggressive subtypes, it provides us with some it benefits for relapse-free and overall survival rate. Rate of reaching complete regression is quite different for different subtypes. In case of biologically aggressive subtypes, these numbers are more than significant. And today, with a double target blockade and with aggressive chemotherapy regimens, in case of triple-negative cancers, we can consider reaching of the complete regression in up to 70% or 80% of our patients. So the question comes following surgery, which we're going to do, mastectomy or organ sparing one, and mastectomy is often done after neoadjuvant chemotherapy. It shows in pathomorphological response complete pathomorphological regression. Then the question is why we perform rather, bad surgery for our patients. It's not that bad for our surgeons, but still this surgery introduces some surgical trauma and it changes life of our patients in the future. So when we talk about surgery treatment after neoadjuvant chemotherapy, there is a big question, how much of a breast should be removed, which scope, which volume of tissue is sufficient to consider it surgically relevant, surgically adequate. And can we talk about any volume of removed tissues if we do surgery to confirm complete pathomorphological or morphological regression? Because as of today, we do not have in our armamentarium methods which would replace surgery. All other instrumental diagnostic methods or combination of them actually do not provide us with 100% sensitivity and 100% specificity, and do not provide us with the right to diagnose complete regression as it is. It's called pathomorphological because we need morphological assessment in an appropriate lab. Well, actually, we are not pioneers with that trial. Moreover, the story of attempts of trying to refuse of surgery is quite a long one. It's the start of 2003. Results of treatment of patients breast cancer patients with complete morphological response with mandatory radiotherapy. And what's interesting, in group of patients with surgery and groups and in patients without surgery, the relapse-free survival rate during 12 years was to be absolutely comparable. Yes, relapses happened, but they happened in both arms, and their incidence and their rate was completely the same. So, as I said, pathomorphological assessment is necessary. We must have it. Methods of assessment are regrettable and not that effective. Conventional methods being used routinely in mammography and ultrasounds are not satisfactory. Sensitivity, specificity of mammography and ultrasound are extremely low. Yes, we do them on a routine fashion. We use Willis palpation. We assess the treatment effects with, so to say, with palpation, but this assessment regrettably is not really reliable. More modern methods, it's PET-CT or FACT-CT. Of course, they provide better sensitivity, but they're not 100% or SPECT-CT. They're not that effective, and we cannot say with 100% assurance that there is no residual tumor. And it's and presence or absence of the residual tumor actually affects post-surgical treatment. And what we turn here, post-neo adjuvant treatment, meaning if previously we talked about the adjuvant treatment, now, today, the treatment regimen, the management of patients post-neo adjuvant therapy actually, basically, fundamentally, depends on if there is a residual tumor or not. So MRI treatment as diagnostic technique for complete response, also regretful, doesn't provide us with a 100% assurance response. So today, regretful assessment effectiveness of neo adjuvant therapy is possible only if we have some material to send to past morphological lab, and production of this material is extremely important to assess effectiveness of neoadjuvant treatment. Today in the world, there is several works. It's the use of vacuum aspirational biopsy to verify complete morphological regress, and it shows absolute negative results. It's worse than instrumental methods, isotope methods, MRI methods. False negative rate reaches 37%. But what I need to say, that assessment of clinical response was done here only with MRI in this protocol, and they use 13G needle, which is means you cannot take much of a tissue, and its value is not that, so to say, good one. It's not sufficient one. So the technique of vacuum aspiration and biopsy was improved, but the rate, false negative rate, is just 17%. Then, but look at this work. Look at the subgroup analysis of this work presented by Dr. Heil last year. We see that a lot depends on how this procedure was done. And if procedure of vacuum aspiration, I mean, it was done with a 7G needle. It is rather thick needle. It's maybe the top-notch, topmost thick needle. It's allowed to take a lot of material and properly predict the response if there is a residual tumor or not. And 7G tumor, it was using 7G needle, and 41% of patients, we see no false negative response. No residual tumor as a result of the all the workup plus aspiration biopsy reaches 6%, and more than 6 biopsies in case of vacuum aspiration biopsy reaches 3%. Also, we have experience, which was today mentioned, confirmation of the complete morphological response prior to surgery. We did neoadjuvant therapy in our patients, and afterwards we did biopsy of the tumor bed and compare it with the data of instrumental diagnostic methods, which was done also after post neoadjuvant therapy. This work has a big advantage. Later on, we did standard surgery. We have information, we have material to compare biopsy data. So biopsy of the tumor bed talked about the sensitivity of 90% on specific so accuracy was 90%, sensitivity was 100%. Other techniques didn't reach it. So the biopsy of the tumor bed, it is the only material which can today confirm or disregard complete clinical regression, which is either complete regression or not after post-neoadjuvant therapy. So it was a protocol, the clinical study, which was registered at theclinicaltrials.gov. where we call the study, our study is refusal of breast surgery. So in inclusion criteria, we do include patients with rather early disease. We're talking about T2, T0 patient, and 0 patient, T1 and 0, T1 and 1 patients. So it's a triple negative or HER2 positive breast cancer. So prior to the treatment, we label primary lesion and regional lymph nodes if there are signs of its involvement, and we verify the influence prior to the neoadjuvant therapy onset along with the labeling procedure. We do then provide chemotherapy, so in HER2 positive chemotherapy with double target block. In triple negative patients, we do anthracycline containing regimens with taxanes and platinum agents like carboplatin. And we indeed, in triple negative patients, we do not enroll patients with BRCA mutation. It is also an exclusion criteria because today we talk only about triple negative patients without BRCA mutation. Then we assess tumor response. We assess it using available diagnostic methods. It's a multidisciplinary diagnostic. In case of residual tumor, we do conventional surgery. If according to instrumental diagnostics there is a residual tumor, then no vacuum aspiration biopsy is discussed. We just remove the tumor in the amount of conventional surgery. It's either mastectomy with reconstructive intervention or organ sparing procedure. If in case of clinical complete response, patient undergoes vacuum aspiration biopsy of the tumor bed using 7G needle, it is very important point as is critical, I mean the needle diameter, and then sentinel node biopsy is done with target accelerated lymph dissection if a lymph node was initially impaired. Then vacuum aspiration biopsy makes possible to obtain sufficient amount of material to gain the proper or the relevant information from the tumor bed, and if in that substrate which is taken with vacuum aspiration biopsy, if there are found signs of residual tumor burden, if it is a residual tumor or tumor in situ or invasive tumor, we do conventional surgery assessing procedure of vacuum aspiration biopsy as a biopsy, as a simple biopsy. So we do surgery applying standard surgical techniques. And in cases we don't find after vacuum aspiration biopsy the tumor cells, then we do radiation therapy with a boost on the tumor bed. And today, the study, we have enrolled 24 patients. 11 of them underwent vacuum aspiration biopsy. 13 of them currently at the stage 11, at the stage of neoadjuvant therapy. One patient refused of vacuum aspiration. It is her right. And she refused with providing complete response, and she underwent surgery. One patient didn't reach a response, and also she underwent surgery. Out of 11 patients with vacuum aspiration biopsy, 8 patients had no tumor cells. In one patient has in situ, HER2 positive tumor, and residual tumor was found in 2 patients. So one was triple negative patients, another person was HER2 positive. Those patients underwent operation with a, according to standard conventional surgical standards. So you see those tumor columns, which used to be the tumor bed. We remove the tissue biopsy with a label because we pre-labeled it. We do X-rays of the removed biopsies to see if the label was actually taken during the procedure. Besides, we do target axillary lymph dissection, which also makes possible to remove lymph node, which initially was confirmed as having metastatic process, and this lymph node is removed to do histology there, to histological studies there. So which questions we've developed during the study? The tumor in situ, complete pathomorphological aggression according to the current classification. But can we refuse of conventional breast surgery? We do not do it yet. But the most important question, how to assess a response on neoadjuvant therapy in case of residual tumor is there? Because RCB system assumes standard conventional approach, but then we have lots of questions which you might also develop, and with some answers which are given at this slide. And at the end of my talk, I should say that maybe several years ago, this presentation would cause a whole set of negative emotions, but today I hope there would be the storm of questions rather than storm of bad opinions, so to say, and I hope you will join us in our studies. Thanks a lot.